giving with one hand and taking with another. It is a sleight of hand or a magician trick, a summit for our economic summit. The Nigerian Economic Summit held in Abuja on Monday, the 7th of October, 2019. And I wonder, apart from the rush to be counted among nations that hold the economic summit, do government ever take advice away from such events? The reason for my question is quite obvious. Because if you still think with such a summit as it is with serious-minded countries who listen to their economic advisors, Nigeria is on a path to greatness, you are probably dreaming and need to wake up fast. I hope they remember to inform the government in that summit that in the age where the world has become a global village and information travels faster than light, no right-thinking business person will invest his hard-earned money in your country where government doesn't obey her own rules and cut orders. Where the biggest business is government, even local businessmen would rather go into politics and government than create businesses. No economy grow where her government pays 12% or more interest on treasury bills and then expect people to establish factories. No nation neglects the education of her youth and expect a prosperous future. What should encourage a businessman to invest his 1 billion naira in agricultural sector when he can get 120 million profit on it by just fixing it in a bank for a few months? What should incentivize someone to create job when he can get 15% profit with a mere phone call or 100% from forest trade? As rightly queried by Adetilewa Adetomiwa, an economist, closing our borders to stop smuggling of goods you don't produce at home, yet opening the same borders for medical tourism for public officials has a crippling effect on an economy. Charging high tariffs on all goods you don't produce or have alternative to, yet budgeting government fund to subsidize the lifestyle of government official is extended stupidity. Having interest rate as high as 35% and then expecting people to establish factories while government officials are busy buying properties abroad with funds from over-inflated government contract is wickedness. Increasing taxes, introducing toll, taxing cash deposit and withdrawal, the direct opposite of an incentive to increase productivity, while retaining huge salaries and expensive vehicles for both the legislatives and legislators is senseless. Lastly, granting amnesties to terrorists, militants, armed bandits, killer headsmen, while trying those that question government spending accountability for treasonable felony is the height of our seriousness. And until we reverse this trend, our economy will continue to be in reverse gear.
Quite. It has been in reverse forever. All those things listed there are just common sense. You don't need more than common sense. You don't need to study economics or law or anything to know that you don't squander money on yourself and then you tell others to go and work. It will never work. I know how much can be made just for being a Forex dealer or working with them to get my Forex and whatever.
The president has code now because he's working hard.
He's working hard at what?
He has code.
I feel sad for this country because we're heading nowhere fast. I don't know what you think.
When we're talking the previous advocacy, what came to mind? I heard that there's a student in Zamfara in a university who actually made a constructive criticism, a bit like what you're saying. He said, look, that this governor, if he sold 5 of his cars, he could fund, and he gave an illustration, and he basically summarized, and they took the guy and imprisoned him.
Yeah.
Now, my question is, and the reason I brought it up is, say, it's all very well us complaining, but Nigeria is a team, and people keep saying, you know, politics is a game of numbers. We're more in Nigeria who know that we're suffering at the hands of a few who are mismanaging our, you know, surely we can team up. Somebody then asked the question, why didn't a lawyer go and represent that student who managed to speak out? Why doesn't somebody in society get behind those who are willing to, you know, put themselves on the line to point out? Because we're never going to stop pointing out these things. That's what a democracy is all about. But then when that person goes forward, it's like, you know, a game of football, and exposes themselves and says, you're doing the wrong thing. What do the rest of us do? Do we get behind them? Or do we stay in our homes and we're armchair critics? You know, what do we do so that that voice of that person is amplified on our behalf?
We live under a dictatorship. We're not in a democracy. That's what you have to understand. Look at the Prime Minister of England prorogued parliament, and he was taken to court, and the Supreme Court said it was illegal.
And immediately, they didn't need to wait for interpretation. Immediately,
that was it.
The speaker said...
No, you see, the question I'm asking,
are people... can't do that. Because me, I'm going to take who to court, and which court, and what will happen when I go to court. If it's
who
difficult
appointed,
to...
Who appointed if it's the CAGM? To, yeah. Who appointed the judge?
No, even you might even argue that the judges everywhere are appointed by somebody. You know, I know the process is always mm-hmm. well laid out, but in the end, things are done by people. So yes. It's that people, is that there's institutions that do their job to ensure checks and balances, and those people who are in those institutions are not the owners of those institutions, and they have vowed and sworn to uphold the values that that country has grown to have. We have no values in Nigeria. Obvious now. Not that we don't have values. And there's no, those in power have subjugated those values.
No, but what I'm saying is, Chuka, we can't. We have a choice. As far as I'm concerned, the choice is before us now more than ever. Are you going to live with a victim mentality, or are you going to actually rise up? This is what the spirit of the advocate says to me. Are you going to actually say we can do something about it, or we're going to forever stay and say we can't do anything? Because for me, that's a dead end. I can't live like that. So I have to always say to myself, there must be a way forward, and I will find it. Well, that's what I'm saying. You start with advocating, then you look for those who are sticking their necks out, and you get behind them.
Well, with funds. Yeah.
Any exactly. way you can.
And so these days, looking for politicians or executives or legislators who are, you know, in the position to also change this situation, but they themselves are also silent, or they themselves are also, they've also joined the bad wagon and contributing to the decadence in the society. You know, I was speaking with a friend some 2 weeks ago, and, you know, he used to be this patriots of Nigeria, sticking his neck out and saying, this country, I would change this country.
Amen.
And just recently, you know, it's something to say amen for, really. So just recently, we had a conversation, and then he said, you know, I'm looking for a way out. And I'm like, even you looking for a way out. He says,
Ekene?
Does that make sense? I'm not looking for a way.
Does that make sense to you?
I know, really. And so I'm like, what was your breaking point? For someone who had, you know, over time said, I am sticking my neck out for this nation, Nigeria will be better. What was your breaking point?
And he says,
not even 2000, this year, when the CJN was, you know, removed from office, how does that happen in a nation? In a democratically nation that a CJN will be removed from office and all 190 million population are keeping quiet about it.
No, but really,
because we don't have a voice.
But did the CJN commit the offences he was guilty of? Because now we have a situation.
I don't think that's the.
Because if you open yourself, Chuka, you can be used.
Let me quickly answer
that.
Your answer is somewhere. I said, a society that truly wants to correct the ills of the society. What do you do when you start a process so as not to be seen to be victimizing such persons? You see it through. The case of the CGN, what has happened, to show that's why people are saying, no, it was all about victimization. You started a process, so he was under investigation. He lodged money here, he lodged money there, and then you want to charge him. So where are we now?
Yes, that's the question.
You know? And so, secondly, the people, you can't talk about people, why are we not standing up? Do you know how many have died standing up?
And then there
is nothing. On those days, under the military, you could get, you know, grants from donors to assist those who were standing up. But now, even you that is standing up, you stand on one leg. You're standing on one leg in terms of, is it socials, financials, or politically? And then you now need, there are so many people also that you are helping to stand. So the situation really, in most cases, is helpless. And take the case of Sowore. We talked about it last week.
I was going there.
He called out for protests. Why the same government is negotiating with killers and saying they are seeing the benefit of giving killers money.
Amnesty.
And then those that are questioning you, you arrest them and you say you want to try them, they are bad losers. And why the matter is in court? Court gave order. You say no, you won't obey. You are even threatening the judge who gave such an order.
And no, liberals, doubtless, these things are happening. What I'm trying to say is the countries that people are checking out to, people fought and died for those countries. Now you want to just emigrate and enjoy. There's nothing you're going to get in this life that you don't have to get it by believing and digging your heels in. It's not going to be given to you on a platter.
You fight even
when there was no system.
There were more systems than you thought.
Okay, maybe we'll look at history of other democracies.
I agree with you. Like I always say, that the mountain you run away from is waiting for you when you come back. But guess what? South Africans we stand or they stood and fought apartheid. Why? Because they know that is hope. So let me borrow the word of Jesus and his followers. He will all, when he said, follow me and I will make you. Who is telling you to follow him or her in Nigeria that he will make you? You are the one making yourself. You are the local government chairman of yourself, the state governor of yourself, the president of the Federal Republic of your family. Does that make sense to you? So when you live in that kind of atmosphere, what is the hope? Listen to me. It has been said that until you give up in your soul, you cannot die. People are giving up every day in Nigeria because there is no hope. So the question is, where
and it's only hope that keeps you alive.
And it's only hope.
We're still here.
That is why we are advocating.
Hope. And so we are giving hope.
Hope 19.
Well, we,
hope 2023.
Yes. So we keep advocating every day for the thief, one day for the owner of the house. Chuka puts a stamp of ownership on his advocacy. Next up.